ever since I started this channel, I've always wanted to make a video on Star Wars The Clone Wars, because it's one of those series that I really love, and it's one of those series that I kind of grew up watching, and it's been a big part of my childhood. And I think that the reason it works so well is because of how weirdly adult it is. Now, before I get into detail, I would like to say that there will be spoilers for this show and Solo, A Star Wars Story, and that there's also already an incredible video on this series by one of my favorite YouTube channels, The Cosmonaut Variety Hour. But unlike that video, I won't be covering the entire show. I'll just be talking about some of my favorite storylines, because this is an anthology series, and of course, my favorite storyline, and the one I'll be talking about in depth, is that of Darth Maul, who, by the way, is my favorite Star Wars villain. Yes, I know we all love Darth Vader, but hopefully by the end of this video essay, I will be able to sort of convince you as to why Darth Maul is my personal favorite. And yes, I will be calling this a video essay, mainly because I am pretentious and full of myself, but also because I want more videos on my video essay playlist. And hopefully I'll also be able to convince you as to why this show in general is just so good and so worth watching. Also, because this show is an anthology series, it basically means you don't have to watch everything. You can watch all the good storylines, just skip out all the bad ones, like R2-D2 going on a mission with some droids. That's just boring. Now, before we get into more storyline, I would like to talk a little bit about the show and some of the awesome things that it has to offer. Anakin Skywalker in this series is by far the best version of Anakin Skywalker. Unlike the man baby that was Hayden Christensen's version, this one is actually charismatic, but also conflicted, just an overall really well-written, complex character. Obi-Wan is my favorite Star Wars character, and so much of that is because of the way he's portrayed in this show. There's one bit in the show where he has to fake his death and go undercover as a bounty hunter to infiltrate the bad guys. It's like the Star Wars version of The Departed, like Obi-Wan is Leonardo DiCaprio and like Count Dooku is Jack Nicholson. Ahsoka is just this incredible addition to the universe, and at first she's a little bit annoying, but she definitely grows on you. She's sort of like the Arya Stark of the Star Wars universe. Another character created just for this show is Ventress, who is also such a badass. So many people nowadays are talking about how Star Wars is all about powerful, capable female characters, but they've been doing it for years in the Clone Wars. Actually, now that we're on the subject of female characters, this show also makes Padme a likable character. She's not just some helpless idiot like she was in the prequels. Going back to Ventress, though, one of my favorite episodes in this series is when she participates in a train robbery set piece, which basically takes up the entire episode and has young Boba Fett, and it's so much better than that train robbery in Solo.
Hey there, what's a pretty bald babe like you doing in a desert like this?
Get lost.
Hey, I'm talking to you, lady.
That's awesome!
I also love that this show explores characters that were only seen in the background or killed off instantly in the prequels. We get to go on adventures with so many awesome Jedi characters like Plo Koon, Luminara, Quinlan Vos. There's also this badass called Evan Peel, who's basically like this battle-hardened version of Yoda with this awesome Eastern European accent.
If they've caught our scent, they'll lead the droids right to us.
We also get Kit Fisto. I mean, just look at this scene of him versus Grievous. It's just awesome. He's also in one of my favorite storylines, in which they go underwater and one of the bad guys is a man shark. Yep, that's right. There is a man shark in the Star Wars universe. Now, you know, I love The Last Jedi, but I would much rather have seen man sharks than porgs. We also get introduced to Pong Krell, who has four arms and wields two double-bladed lightsabers. Yeah. That's right, you heard me. Two double-bladed lightsabers. We also get this awesome bounty hunter called Ember, who surfs on his hat. Legolas surfs on a shield, this guy surfs on his hat. Also, this being an animated series means that it's able to get away with certain filmmaking techniques that live action isn't capable of. And so we're able to get these incredible wide, long takes of lightsaber fights. And you know, the camera's moving in ways and in angles that you can't do with real life. And that's one of the advantages of being an animated series. Final thing before I talk about Darth Maul. There's this one storyline where Anakin, Obi-Wan, and Ahsoka go to this planet, which is home to like the Force gods. There's this Gandalf, Dumbledore looking motherfucker. It's awesome. So now let's look at my favorite storyline and how and why it works so well as this classic revenge story. So in case you didn't know, Darth Maul did survive being cut in half by Obi-Wan, managing to live on because of his pure hatred and desire for revenge against the man who bested him in combat. Years later, his brother, Savage Opress, who is, by the way, just a complete tank, goes in search for him after being jacked up on some adrenaline venom type spell and beating like so many of the main characters. He goes and finds Maul as this decrepit creature with spider legs. Long story short, Maul gets proper legs again and goes on a revenge path, hunting down Obi-Wan and making the galaxy his bitch along the way. Also, it concludes in the best lightsaber fight in Star Wars history. So why does this work so well? I think that all good classic revenge stories share certain narrative points, one of the most important being the inciting incident, basically the thing that makes these characters go in the direction that they're going in. So for example, Mark Zuckerberg creates Facebook because he gets dumped. John hunts down all these people because he gets his dog killed. Shoshana plots to kill the Nazis because the family gets murdered. And Darth Maul goes on this journey because of his hatred for Obi-Wan. This is obviously a vital part of the character's arc because even though Maul is a villain, the showrunners actually take their time to explain and almost justify his motivations. We don't have to agree with him, but at least we can understand why he's doing what he's doing. And because of this, we are far more invested in the story and we can almost root for the character. Very similar to Black Panther or Infinity War. After the inciting incident, we basically have everything else. Everything that Maul does to get him to Obi-Wan and get his revenge. Now this is where we really get to see the fun stuff. Maul obviously runs into Obi-Wan quite a few times, which leads to many awesome lightsaber fights and team-ups between fan-favorite characters. Also, we get to see Savage Opress headbutt this wounded gazelle of a Jedi. And remember, he has horns, so yeah. This part of the arc really has some of my favorite moments in all of Star Wars. There's this one bit where Maul is just taking over all the different criminal gangs and syndicates in the galaxy, which of course leads him to his powerful position that we see him in Solo. He also teams up with the Death Watch and beats their leader in like trial by combat, and then like gets his Darksaber, which is like the coolest weapon in Star Wars. Now the reason this part of the arc is so effective is because there's a genuine sense of character progression. We see Maul go from some centipede man to basically the godfather of the criminal underworld of Star Wars. But it doesn't just happen immediately. The writers take their time to show the progression of this story. And most importantly, they show the mistakes that he makes and the consequences of these mistakes. They make him vulnerable. So because we get to see him at his lowest, it's so much more satisfying to see him on top. Now, this being a kids' TV show, I think that most people probably would expect him to fail and get captured or something, but he doesn't. Maul kind of wins. He gets his revenge on Obi-Wan. He kills the woman that Obi-Wan loves, who, by the way, she's always reminded me of like Vera Farmiga, like Cate Blanchett. I just want to put that out there. But you actually get to see Obi-Wan suffer. You don't expect this from a kid's show, but it's so awesome. Now that he's completed his arc in a very satisfying way, the writers also do a brilliant job of closing up his storyline. Basically, he loses in a fight with Darth Sidious, which I'll say again is one of the best, if not the best, fights in Star Wars. But then they leave his story with a bit of ambiguity to be sort of continued in Star Wars Rebels. And you know, ambiguity is something you don't expect in a kid's cartoon. So I guess why this storyline works so well and why the entire show works so well is because they genuinely take their time to build anticipation and pay it off in a really satisfying way. And they also utilize storytelling techniques that are far more complex than anything else you see in kids' TV shows nowadays. Except for Avatar The Last Airbender and Batman The Animated Series. I've always wanted to make videos about those and hopefully I'll get to them eventually. But this show succeeds where films like Solo and maybe even Rogue One fail by going that extra mile and building characters and crafting conflicts fueled by understandable motivations and taking risks to tell stories that are fun, complex, and most importantly, unpredictable.